It's really a blessing to be here tonight at First Baptist Church. I've been here several times. I live in Jonesboro with my wonderful wife, Lori. We've got two kids, Elijah and Shoshi, both college students. And I so appreciate Pastor Dean, his heart for the Jewish people, Harvest of Israel, a phenomenal ministry, and just your heart to see the Jewish people come to know Jesus as Messiah, Lord, and Savior. I really appreciate your heart. So it's really a privilege to be here to share this Christ in the Passover presentation. I was telling Pastor Dean before we started, I said, Passover doesn't get any better than this. Right place, right time, right talk. Amen? But I want to tell you something. I'm a Jewish believer in Jesus. I came to faith in Jesus Christ in 1987, many moons ago. But growing up, Jesus and Jewish did not go together. I grew up in a Reform Jewish household in Florida, a liberal expression of Judaism, culturally and socially, very much connected to the Jewish community, spiritually and religiously, not so connected to God. But I always believed in God, and I believed that somehow He knew me and that I was special in His eyes. The first time people started coming and sharing their faith with me was at an institution of higher learning down in Gainesville, Florida, that shall remain unnamed. I'm a Gator boy. I'm already testing your grace quotient, aren't I? But it was at Florida people were sharing their faith in Jesus with me. Initially, I didn't want to hear about their Jesus, but the Holy Spirit kept coming, kept moving. People kept coming. A friend of mine named Greg was a believer, was sharing his testimony with me. He said, Larry, there's absolute truth and you can get in touch with it. I was like, whoa, it's a little bit heavy. He posed a question. He said, do you know where you came from? Do you know who you are? Do you know where you're going when you die? I had no idea how to begin answering that question. And it sent me spiraling into what we might call an existential crisis of sorts. I started searching. I didn't necessarily embrace my Judaism or Christianity, but I started to search and explore different philosophies, worldviews, and religions. Fast forward on my journey, a year after I graduated from Florida, I'm now living in St. Pete. I'm flying home from Atlanta. I'm on the airplane reading The Story of Philosophy by a gentleman named Will Durant. Guy sat next to me all wide-eyed. He looked over, he said, oh, a philosophy book. Are you interested in philosophy? Had to arch my back and go, yeah, I am. He said, great, man, let's talk. I have a master's degree in philosophy. We have a lot to talk about. And those of you who've seen me here before probably might find this surprising, but he actually did most of the talking. He shared his faith in Jesus with me. He said, you tell me you're Jewish, you believe in God? I said, yeah. He said, I challenge you. Why don't you ask the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob if Jesus is the promised Messiah, and He will show you the truth. I was like, okay. Got off the airplane that day, prayed a deep theological prayer. I said, God, help. I don't know about Jesus, Messiah, the Bible, or Christianity, but I believe you're real. Show me. Prayed that prayer in September of 1987, early December 1987, 3 months later. I once was blind, but now I could see. I once was lost, but now I was found. I believe for the first time that Jesus was and is the Messiah. I believe that He died for my sins and rose again from the dead. And I put my faith and trust in Him to be my Lord, my Savior, my Messiah, my God. And that was the beginning of my journey. And as I started to study the New Testament, we never read the New Testament in the synagogue, I assure you. Started reading the New Testament. Jesus, Jewish, the disciples, Jewish. All the writers of the New Testament, with the possible exception of Luke, Jewish. In one sense, you could say the Gospels are simply a Jewish debate among Jewish people about the true identity of a Jewish man, Jesus. And the story takes place in Israel. Now, what could be more Jewish than that? And I thought to myself, why didn't anybody tell me this before? And I got so excited about that reality, connecting the dots, that God brought me into ministry to my Jewish people. I did two missionary journeys with a ministry called Jews for Jesus, 6.5 years in the Big Apple, telling my Jewish people and anybody else willing to listen that Jesus is the promised Messiah, that it's kosher to believe in Him, whether you're Jewish or Gentile. As Pastor Dean mentioned, I was also on a church staff for 4 years. The last 9-plus years, my wife Lori and I, we live in Jonesboro. We've been doing Larry Stamm Ministries. I'll tell you a little bit more about that later. But our ministry, we exist to make the gospel of Jesus a confident topic of conversation for every Christian. I've got a heart to help Christians learn how to effectively share their faith, not only with Jews, but with anybody and everybody that God brings across your path. A presentation like this tonight is a connecting the dots kind of presentation. It is a gospel strengthening presentation. And I argue that when we better understand the gospel message, we're going to be more effective in sharing that message. Amen? So I hope and pray this is a blessing to you. And are you excited to see the Christ in the Passover? Amen. Now, if you were to ask some Jewish boys or girls who the hero of Passover is, after giving credit to the Lord, they will certainly tell you Moses. And that's true, but it's not the whole truth. You see, if you were to ask some Jewish boys or girls who know the Messiah that same question, who is the hero of Passover, then they might tell you Jesus. Now, some people, probably not anybody in this room, but some people might say, Larry, what's Jesus got to do with Passover? Passover is Jewish. Well, so is Jesus. Not only did Jesus celebrate the Passover every year while he dwelt among us on this earth, I believe Jesus is clearly pictured in all of the symbols of Passover and in the story of Passover itself. For the message of Passover is the promise of redemption. And the story of Passover is the story of our liberation from bondage. Tonight, as I explain to you all this traditional Passover setting, it's my hope that you're going to see it as much more than just an explanation of a commemorative meal, but that you're going to view it as I view it, as an object lesson of the life and mission of the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Look closely, friends, because I believe that you're going to see a picture of his death, his burial, and his resurrection. If you have a Bible, I encourage you to turn with me to Luke chapter 22. We're going to be reading verses 7 through 13, Luke 22. As we've mentioned, Passover begins tonight at sundown. Luke 22, we'll read verses 7 through 13. Beginning in verse 7 of Luke 22, we read, Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. And he sent Peter and John, saying, Go and prepare the Passover for us, that we may eat. So they said to him, Where do you want us to prepare? And he said to them, Behold, when you have entered the city, a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house which he enters. Then you shall say to the master of the house, The teacher says to you, Where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? Then he will show you a large furnished upper room. There, make ready. So they went and found it just as he had said to them, and they prepared the Passover. The first night of Passover begins a seven-day holiday called the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And during this time, we eat nothing that contains any leaven or yeast. Why no leaven? Well, in the scripture, leaven is frequently used as a symbol of sin. In ancient times, a small piece of leaven would be used to ferment an entire portion of dough. It was the leaven that caused the dough to rise, to become puffed up, just as sin can cause us to become puffed up in our own eyes. So during this time, we eat nothing that contains any leaven or yeast as a way of saying that we want to break the daily sin cycle in our own lives. That's why in some Orthodox Jewish homes, for up to 6 weeks prior to Passover, the house will undergo a complete spring cleaning. All the cakes, cookies, bread, cereals, they're removed. And once the house has been cleansed, the home is now ready for the Passover celebration. And it is a celebration. But my ancestors were instructed to eat that first Passover meal with their loins girded, with their sandals on their feet, and with their staves in hand, ready to go at a moment's notice. But tonight, you'll notice that we have pillows. You see, in the ancient Middle East, only the free could recline at dinner. Only the redeemed. Now, what's going to happen in some Orthodox Jewish families is the head of the household, the night before Passover, is going to come home. The wife has hidden. She's cleansed the house, but she's hidden a little bit of leaven in the house. So the night before Passover, the man will return home and take up some rather strange-looking cleaning tools, including a napkin, a wooden spoon, and a feather. And he goes on what we call berichat chametz, the search for leaven. Now, where could those crumbs be? Anywhere, in the basement, up in the attic, behind the refrigerator. But fortunately enough for him, she's been good enough to hide them exactly where she hid them the year before that, and the year before that, and you get the idea. Nice wife, right? So once he discovers the crumbs, he's gonna wrap them up in this napkin. Remember, the crumbs represent sin. He can't touch them. Instead, he'll wrap them up in this napkin, and in some traditions, actually take it down to the courtyard of the local synagogue. Now, all the men of the congregation will be gathered there, and each will then throw his bundle of leaven into the flames. Then he'll return home and proudly proclaim, "Now I have purged my house of all leaven." But just to be certain, he'll add, "And all manner of leaven which I have neither seen nor removed be considered null and void and as the dust of the earth. Amen." Well, the house has been cleansed and the home is now ready for the Passover celebration. Now, on Passover, the head of the household is going to wear special ceremonial garments. He's going to wear a white robe called a kittel, because in Jewish tradition, white is the color of royalty. He'll also don a large white headdress called a mitre. Now, if you know what I'm wearing, blurt it out. What is this? That's right, it's a kippah or yarmulke. Jewish men will often cover their heads as a sign of respect before God, but tonight, instead of wearing the usual yarmulke or kippah, the head of the household puts on something a little bit more elaborate. Royal robes and symbol of a crown, because tonight the head of the household is a king. And as a king, he's going to guide his family through the traditional Passover Seder. Now, Seder is a Hebrew word which means order, because the Passover celebration follows a specific order of service. And that order is recorded right here in this book called a Haggadah. A Haggadah, which means the telling. Well, I see everything is about ready. We have a customary greeting at Passover. We say, "Let all who are hungry come and eat." Now, don't get excited. I'm not really going to serve you a great meal tonight, but just the same, the invitation stands. Come, celebrate the Passover with me. This begins with the lighting of the candles, and this is usually the duty and honor of the woman of the house. The perils of live presentation, right? Is the speaker going to burn his hand? That was close. After lighting the candles, the woman of the house will recite a traditional Hebrew prayer, which goes like this. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Asher Kidshanu B'Mitzvotov V'Tzivanu L'Hadlik Ner Shel Pesach. Blessed art thou, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has set us apart with your commandments and commanded us to light the Passover lights. I think it's fitting that a woman kindles these lights, for it can remind us that the Messiah, the light of the world, would not come from the seed of man, but from the seed of woman. As the prophet Isaiah foretold, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and she shall call his name Emmanuel, a light of revelation to the Gentiles and glory of thy people Israel." Well, friends, I want you to know something tonight. Passover is much more than a meal. It's a banquet. And it's much more than a service. It's a ceremony. And while a meal and a service might take just 1 or 2 hours, the Passover celebration may take a total of up to 4 hours. Dinner plans, anybody? No, I'm not going to keep you that long. But seders, actual seders, can actually take that long, okay? I've been part of them many times. Now, the first cup we have is called the cup of sanctification. And during the Seder, each adult will drink from his or her cup and refill it 4 times. And the first cup is called the cup of sanctification. The second cup we have is the cup of plagues. Then we have the third cup, the cup of redemption. And then we have the fourth cup, the cup of Hallel, or the cup of praise. It's with the first cup, the cup of sanctification, that the host will offer a blessing for the rest of the evening to follow. Raising the Kiddush cup aloft, he'll give praise and thanks to God Almighty, King of the universe, creator of the fruit of the vine.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Amen.
The Seder has begun, and the youngest person present will come forward to ask the meaning of Passover. He or she will ask the traditional four questions which are found in the Haggadah. They are chanted, and the first one goes like this.
Man ishtana ha-layla hazeh mikol ha-laylot,
which means, why is this night different than all other nights? Those of us who know the story of Passover were obligated to respond. This is because of what the Lord did for me when he brought me out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, when he redeemed me with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm.
Friends, redemption is the very heart of Passover. But Passover imparts much more than God's message of redemption. It also imparts God's means of redemption through the sacrifice of a Passover lamb. My ancestors were instructed to take a spotless lamb, to roast it whole without breaking any of its bones, and to apply its blood to the doorposts of our homes, to the top of the doorpost, the lintel, and to the two side posts. Because of our obedience to God's command, and because of our faith in the effectiveness of his provision, we were spared the ravages of the 10th plague to befall the land of Egypt. For when the Lord saw the blood on our doors, he forced death to do what? That's right, Passover. In Hebrew, we say Pesach, Pesach. You got to get the ch, ch, ch on the Pesach, ch, ch. Can you say that with me? Pesach. Very good, very good. Pesach, the holiday which commemorates the time when death passed over the houses of Israel because of the blood. The blood of the Lamb, the Passover Lamb. What a mighty act of redemption. But what a picture. What a picture of an even greater redemption accomplished through the sacrifice of another Passover Lamb, the Lamb of God, our Messiah and Lord, Jesus. For just as none of the bones of those first lambs were broken, so none of Jesus' bones were broken in his death. And just as my ancestors had to apply in faith the blood of the Lamb to the doorposts of their homes, so each one of us must apply in faith the blood of the Messiah to the doorposts of our hearts. Amen? The child will then ask another question. Why on this night do we eat only unleavened bread, matzah? And we explain, our ancestors in their haste to leave Egypt had to take their bread with them while it was still flat. Now, one of the items I want to show you now is this one. This is called the matzah tash, and inside the matzah tash are three layers of unleavened bread matzah, each layer separated from the others by some cloth. Now, tonight, around the world, there will be men who are leading that Passover Seder. And what's going to happen is, he's going to remove the middle layer, recite a blessing. By the way, all the blessings in the order of service, as I mentioned, found in the Haggadah, the order of service, right? He's going to recite a blessing. He's going to break the matzah tash in two. He'll set one half aside and give the other half a very special name, the Afikomen. The Afikomen. Can you say that with me? Afikomen. Very good. That's not a Hebrew word, by the way. It's actually a Greek word, which means that which comes later, and that is precisely what happens. We do not eat the Afikomen yet. We're going to eat it later. But for now, what we'll do is we'll wrap it up in this napkin, and then it's going to be hidden from view, buried. No one at the table knows where it's hidden, but later on, all the young people are going to have to search for it and find it, or the Seder can't continue and conclude. So at this point in our evening's festivities, I want all the young people who are going to come up in a few moments and find the Afikomen,
You have to stand up and face the back of the auditorium and close your eyes, okay? Because I've got to hide this. I don't want you to see where I'm hiding it. So believe me, I brought a prize all the way from the big city. Not New York City, where I used to minister, but Johnson City, okay? But I have brought an awesome prize. You're going to love this prize, believe me, okay? So young people, stand up. Don't be bashful. Believe me, the prize is worth it. Stand up. Face the back of the auditorium, close your eyes, okay? Also, young at heart can play too, so young people, stand up, face the back. Go ahead and stand up, face the back. Believe me, when you get this prize, you're gonna be pumped, okay? Young people going once, face the back, okay? Any other, okay, good. Now, I've gotta get really creative where I'm gonna hide this off you comb, and you know, really creative. I wonder where I'll hide it, okay? All right, let's see. Music equipment, no, that's off limits. Okay. All right, I found a place to hide the Afikoman. And you can open your eyes and turn around. Okay, can you be patient? Patience is a virtue, young man, okay? But in a few moments, I'm gonna call you up and it'll be your time to shine, okay? Now, the child will then proceed to ask two more questions. Why on this night do we eat only bitter herbs? And why on this night do we dip our food twice when normally we do not dip it once? Let me explain by showing you this. This is a Seder plate, and despite its appearance, it is not used for deviled eggs. I know some of you at this point are probably thinking, good thing this guy's a minister and not a comedian, right? But actually, a symbolic piece of food from the Passover table is placed into each one of these compartments, and all of these symbols are part of the picture of redemption. Are we beginning to notice a common theme running throughout our time tonight? Redemption, to be purchased back out of slavery. And that's exactly what the Lord Jesus did for us when he shed his blood on the cross. We were redeemed. Now, the first item is called carpus or greens. Generally, we're going to use parsley or lettuce. And these greens represent life. But before we eat them, we're going to dip them into salt water. So I've got the parsley here. And the salt water represents tears. So by dipping, we are reminded that a life without redemption is a life immersed in tears. Can you remember your life before redemption? I certainly can. Next, we have the chazeret, the root of the bitter herb. Now, generally, we're going to use an onion or a horseradish root, in this case, an onion. And the chazeret reminds us that the root of life is bitter, as it certainly was for my ancestors in Egypt. Next, we have maror, the bitter herb itself, freshly ground horseradish. Now, tonight, on Passover, we are instructed to eat a full teaspoon of horseradish. Any volunteers? Do you all know what happens when you eat a full teaspoon of horseradish? That's right, you cry. You have little choice in the matter. This is a battle between a horseradish and your sinuses, and guess what? Horseradish always wins. I was listening to the radio on my way here, and the announcer was talking about allergies, how so many of you are afflicted. You want to help you with your allergies? This stuff is like Jewish Dristan, you know what I'm talking about? This is good stuff here. By way of contrast now, and one more thing I want to say about the maror, like the chazeret, again, the horseradish, the maror brings to our minds how bitter life is without redemption. By way of contrast now, we have the haroseth. And the haroseth represents the mortar that our ancestors used when they had to make bricks for Pharaoh in Egypt. Generally, it's made up of chopped apples, raisins, honey nuts, and it tastes wonderful. But maybe you're thinking, why use such a sweet mixture to represent such bitter toil? Don't worry, we have a terrific answer. We explain, even the most bitter labor is sweetened with the promise of redemption. Very good, redemption, that's right. This is not an Easter egg, although Easter, Resurrection Day, is coming up Sunday. This is actually called the Haggigah, which originally was the name given to the special temple sacrifice in Jerusalem. Today, it takes on a whole new meaning for my people. Today, it's actually a token of grief, grief over the destruction of the second temple. We roast the egg and that turns it brown, and during the Seder,
It's broken open, sliced, given out to each person at the table. But before we eat it, we're going to dip it into the salt water. And the salt water again represents what? That's right, tears. Interestingly, it's not only a token of grief, it is also a symbol of new life. The last item on the plate, probably the strangest of all, is called the Zeruah. The Zeruah is the shank bone of the lamb. Passover is sometimes known as the Feast of the Passover Lamb, and yet in most Jewish homes, roasted lamb is not served. You say, well, why is that? Well, remember a moment ago I mentioned the temple was destroyed in 70 AD, and when it was, so was the altar where those sacrifices were offered, where those Passover lambs were offered. So from that time to this day, no sacrifices have been offered, and so no lamb is served at Passover. Instead, this Zeruah, like the egg, the Haggigah, reminds us of sacrifices which are no longer offered. Now, the presence of these two elements, the egg and the shank bone, raises for us tonight a very, very interesting question. With no temple, with no altar, and with no sacrifice, how is it possible to atone for our sins? For the law of Moses states very clearly in Leviticus 17:11, the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood by reason of the life that makes atonement. Now, some people might say, you know, Larry, perhaps that was important 2,000 years ago, but it doesn't really have any bearing on our lives today, does it?
Yes.
Doesn't it? If nothing, why does the Haggadah instruct us to take the story of Passover personally, as though each one of us were being brought out of Egypt? I think that we're supposed to take the story of redemption personally because each one of us needs to be redeemed. But with no sacrifice, how is redemption even possible? With no Lamb of God, how? Once, nearly 2,000 years ago, there lived a Jewish man by the name of Yochanan. You might know him better as John the Baptist. And one day, while baptizing people in the Jordan River, his gaze fell upon the form of another Jewish man, his cousin, a man named Yeshua. We know him better as? And John gazed upon Jesus and he spoke these words. He said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." That's how. Redemption, not through the blood of lambs, redemption through the blood of the Passover Lamb. The Lamb of God, our Messiah and Lord, Jesus. We now come to the second cup, the cup of plagues. In Jewish tradition, a full cup represents complete joy, but in one sense, our joy is not complete. All around the world, in homes and synagogues, we're going to dip our finger in the cup, and we're going to let 10 drops fall onto our plates as we recite the 10 plagues that were poured out upon the Egyptians. Now we mourn their loss and we express sorrow over their destruction. There's a very important lesson in this cup. Pharaoh defied the will of God. He was repeatedly told what God wanted him to do, but his heart was hardened and he said, "Nope, I refuse, I will not." As a result, he brought death and destruction not only upon his land, but even into his own home. You see, friends, Pharaoh's son died because of his hardness of heart. Now tonight, right here in Morristown, Tennessee, I think about my life. You all think about your lives. How often do we choose our own desires over God's direction? How often do we know what God's will is for our lives, but how often do we say to the Lord, "Lord, it's too hard, Lord, I can't do that. Lord, I'm sorry." Let me give all of us a little piece of Jewish wisdom this evening, okay? If God is telling us to do something, that's right, just do it. But as I've said, tonight is a wonderful night to praise and thank God, and around the world, my people are going to praise and thank God because the angel of death has passed over our ancestors' homes and because the Lord has redeemed our people out of bondage in Egypt. But you know, not only tonight, which is a special night in Judaism and a special night for my Jewish people, not only tonight, but every day
from the rising of the sun to the setting of the sun, I'm going to praise and thank God because I have been redeemed from an even greater bondage, the bondage of sin, through my faith in Jesus, the Lamb of God. Through faith in Him, each one of us may pass over from death unto life. And all God's people said, amen. That's good news, isn't it? That's the best news. In Hebrew, the word is Besarah Tovah. Besarah Tovah is a Hebrew word which means glad tidings or good news, from which we get the word gospel. So at this point, between the second and third cup, there is actually the partaking of the Seder meal itself. Now, if you were in a synagogue, or you were at a home somewhere, my family is in Atlanta tonight celebrating the Passover. Okay? What breaks my heart is there's no Jesus in the midst of that Passover Seder. Okay? No Jesus. I'm the only Christian in my family. But between the second and third cup, gonna have a roast brisket, chicken, matzo ball soup, everything kosher, of course, right? No lamb. I never had lamb growing up until I got saved. And as a Christian, the most appropriate thing to eat on Passover is lamb. Amen? But only if it's well prepared. I have to warn you. It has to be good. But at this point, I want to take a brief break and just tell you a little bit more about our ministry, Larry Stamm Ministries. I don't think I mentioned this before when I shared a little bit of my salvation story, but I want you to know that I came to faith in Jesus Christ exclusively and only through the faithful testimony of people just like you. There was my friend Greg in college at Florida. I mentioned him, and there was another gentleman, Herb, who I tried to sell TV time with my senior year at Florida and an internship, and then there was this guy, Steve, on the airplane. Not one time did I listen to or watch a Greg Laurie on TV or radio. I didn't go to a Bible study, didn't go to a church, didn't go online. Young people, back in the 1980s, there was no online, okay? But it was strictly through the testimony of people just like you that God used to save a person just like me. I am the product of marketplace evangelism. I define the marketplace as anywhere outside the walls of this church. You know where your mission field is? You know where my mission field is? When you step outside the doors of this church after this service, there is our mission field, amen? And it may be in a land far, far away, or it could be in your own house, could be across the street. But God has placed you uniquely, just like He placed Esther, for such a time as this. So my heartbeat really is to help the Christian learn how to more effectively share their faith in Jesus. I've written a few books. My first book is Serving in His Court, which is a book about personal evangelism. My third book is a book that we published in 2021. I don't think I've shared this book with the church family, but the last time I was here, and I've been here a few times, but I think the first time since COVID, this is Jewish Roots of Christianity, a biblical survey of redemptive history from Genesis to Revelation. So, Pastor Dean, you read the book. Did you like the book? You recommend the book? See, we talked about it. He's going to do my bidding, okay? Just kidding. No, the infomercial will soon be over. But seriously, this is a really good Bible study. You talk about things like messianic prophecy, the Trinity in the Old Testament. Do you know that all the feasts? Did anybody ever see me when I came and did Christ in the Feast of Tabernacles? Anybody were here way back when? Talk about Christ in the Feast of Tabernacles, Christ in the Feast of Pentecost, by the way, Acts chapter 2, Pentecost 50th. That's the Jewish Feast of Shavuot. So really cool studies like that. The first three chapters of the book, this book, Jewish Roots of Christianity, I spend exclusively on the gospel message. The most important thing first. If you remember, the Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4, these words, "For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ, or Messiah, died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again on the third day, according to the Scriptures." Of what Scriptures was Paul referring? That's right, the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures, otherwise known as the Jewish Bible, or Tanakh in Jewish religious circles. So I spend three chapters of the book on the gospel message. So this is a really good introduction. If this is new to you and you're interested in learning more, I recommend the book. And really, the best part of the book is not that I wrote it and not the content therein. I was telling Pastor Dean earlier, the best part about this book is the bibliography. There's a lot of good stuff in here, and you can go a lot deeper. I brought some things for purchase, books and DVDs, also some free literature like this, Pointers on Witnessing. I encourage you to get it. I write a weekly devotional message sent out free to your e-box. If you want to get that, come sign up at our desk. It's about 1,000 words. Send it out free if you want encouragement in your witness. We do that as well. And one more thing I want to say. We're a small ministry. If you want us to pray for a loved one who doesn't yet know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, come up to me at the literature table afterward. Share their name and any details you want. I'll put them on our prayer list, and we will pray. I have a network of churches that also partner with us in prayer, and I'll lift them up. And we've had people come to faith. Put them on the prayer list. We lift them up to the throne of grace. People have gotten saved. So I encourage you, if you want us to be praying for you and with you and for the witness of others to them, okay, I encourage you, pray for the salvation of my lost family, okay? I'm the only Christian in my family. So with that, we are ready to continue. Have you enjoyed your Seder experience so far? Now be honest, that matzo ball soup, the best you ever had, right? Okay, we're going to continue now with the third cup, the cup of redemption, which, as I mentioned, is the focal point of the entire evening. But the Seder can't continue just yet because something is missing, young people. This is your time, young people, to chirp up. It's now your time to find the afikoman, the matzah in that white pouch. So if you stood back there and you closed your eyes, come on up and find the afikoman. Come on up, young man. Believe me, you're going to like this prize. We have to help them. We've got to help this young man. You got to tell them if they're getting warm, if they're getting cold, or they're getting hot. You got to look under stuff. Don't be afraid. Look under stuff. Come on up here, young man. Wow. You're a ringer. Good job. Now, what's your name?
Drew.
What is it?
Drew.
Drew. I used to be a tennis coach, Drew, so give me a high five. Good job, man. Good job. Now, you ready for your prize, Drew? Now, you remember the horseradish we talked about a few minutes ago? You remember, right? That's not your prize. Aren't you glad? Now, close your eyes, Drew. I've got a prize for you. Close your eyes. Ready? Now, open them. It's a golden dollar for you. All right. Good job. Give me another high five. Let's give him a big hand. Good work. You can go take your seat. Good job, buddy. Good job. I wouldn't do that to the boy. Now, I only eat horseradish once a year. I'm not a big fan, and you're a smart group. You know when that is. Okay. So what happens is the afikoman's return to the head of the household, and then each person will receive a piece of the afikoman about the size of an olive. And that olive-sized piece is then taken along with the third cup, the cup of redemption. Does this look familiar? It should, for this is the origin of our communion service. And not only that, consider this. Where else can we find a clearer picture of our Messiah Jesus than in this custom concerning the afikoman, which was broken, buried, and then brought back? Even the matzah itself, which is unleavened, a symbol of a sinless nature, speaks of Jesus. Now, our rabbis have set down very specific regulations concerning the preparation of matzah if it's to be found suitable for use. And one of these is that the matzah must be pierced. You see those holes in the matzah? In addition, notice the stripes. Now, Jesus was pierced. God, speaking through the prophet Zechariah, said, "They shall look upon me whom they have pierced." In addition, talked about the holes. Now we talk about the stripes and the holes. The prophet Isaiah wrote 700 years before Jesus walked this earth as a man these words, and perhaps the most powerful messianic prophecy in the entire Old Testament, Isaiah 53. Isaiah wrote these words about the work of Messiah on our behalf when he wrote that he was pierced for our transgressions, and by his stripes we are healed. But I see our Messiah symbolically not only in the afikoman, I also see him in the matzah tosh as well. Do you remember this pouch containing the three layers of matzah from which we drew the afikoman?
Now, there's quite a bit of disagreement among our rabbis about the meaning of this strange pouch, this mysterious three-in-one. Now, some teach that the matzahs represent the three patriarchs of Israel, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But why is the middle matzah broken, buried, and then brought back? Others teach that the matzahs represent the three divisions of worship in the ancient kingdom, the priests, the Levites, and the people of Israel. But again, why is the middle matzah broken, buried, and then brought back? Still others teach that the matzahs represent three crowns, the crown of learning, the crown of priesthood, and the crown of kingship. But still, why is the middle matzah broken, buried, and then brought back? In the Jewish community today, as we speak, the origin of this tradition has been lost. That's why there are so many competing explanations. But there's actually another explanation which has its roots in the first century. There are three layers here, and yet they form a unity, a tri-unity. And a Hebrew word which may mean just such a unity is the word echad, echad. And it brings to my mind the words of God given to us through Moses, who declared, Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. The Hebrew word used for one in that sentence is echad, a unity. And around the world tonight, even as we speak, perhaps, the head of the household is going to remove the middle layer of this echad, this unity. It is made visible while the other two remain hidden from our view. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus, the bread of life. We Jewish people who know Messiah know also that the unity of the Matzatash bears witness to the unity of one God revealed in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And so once more, the question must be posed. Why is the middle matzah broken, buried, and then brought back? I believe because Jesus was broken, buried, and then brought back. This is my body, which is broken for you and you and you and all of us. Do this in remembrance of me, our Lord Jesus tells us. We now come to the third cup, the cup of redemption. The fruit of the vine at Passover is usually red, our rabbis tell us, to remind us of the precious blood of that first Passover lamb sacrificed in order to redeem us from slavery and bondage to Pharaoh. In the same way, the blood of another Passover lamb, our Messiah Jesus, was sacrificed in order to redeem us from slavery and bondage to sin. It was concerning this cup, the cup of redemption, the cup taken after dinner, that Jesus would say, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for many for the forgiveness of sins." He spoke of the new covenant promised to us by God through the prophet Jeremiah when he declared, "Behold, days are coming when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. After those days, I will put my law within them, and on their hearts will I write it, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Amen. The broken piece of Afikoman is taken along with the third cup, the cup of redemption, in remembrance of the body and blood of the Passover lamb. Friends, tonight, my Passover lamb is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. We now come to the fourth cup, the cup of Hallel, or the cup of praise. Now, everybody in this room knows a Hebrew word, but I wonder if you all know that the word is Hebrew. And the word is hallelujah. And it means what? Praise the Lord, that's right. The first part of that word is hallel, which means praise. And this is the cup of praise. Well, there's one final cup I want to share with you. The
This is the cup of Elijah. No one drinks from the cup of Elijah. In fact, tonight, as we're sharing, perhaps in other time zones around the world, Passover has begun. An entire place setting is left untouched, all for the prophet Elijah. In thousands upon thousands upon thousands upon thousands of Jewish homes around the world, this place setting is left untouched, all for the prophet Elijah. And you wonder why? Why this longing for the prophet Elijah? Well, it's recorded by the Hebrew prophet Malachi that before the Messiah comes, he will be preceded by the return of Eliyahu Hanavi, Elijah the prophet. And so every year at Passover, a child is going to go to the door and open it wide, hoping that the prophet will accept the invitation, enter the home, and announce the coming of the Messiah. I've got great news for us tonight right here in Morristown, Tennessee. I know that Elijah has returned. For when Jesus spoke of the prophet John, he said of him, if you care to accept it, he himself is Elijah who has come. The prophet, the forerunner of the Messiah, has come. And so has the Messiah himself, Jesus, the Savior of both Jew and Gentile. Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.